Hi. Good afternoon, Olaf. Good afternoon, Lauren. Good afternoon, Golden Gate. We are here today to present about the topic automation bias and how automation becomes, in the end, the spirit that we summon. So the idea with machine learning and data used by AI was the more you feed those sophisticated algorithms with infos, the better they perform. This, however, turned out to be a fallacy. Okay, let me first introduce my team. We got Lana from Canada. We got Maria from Russia. We got Jonathan from Australia, Raphael from Brazil, and Christian and me, Philip, from Germany. So let's start with the definition. Automation bias is an over-reliance on automated tools. So in our case, that would be we have an intelligent system and we have humans teaching this system human prejudices. So this being said, we can talk about why this becomes a problem. The problem arises while technology spreads into critical areas like healthcare, insurances, justice system, or recruitment. So today we're going to double click on the justice system in order to use justice system as an example to demonstrate the effects of automation bias. These are our key actors, and I want to put the attention on some of them, minorities, which is especially black people. We got the algorithm per se, Compass, which is used by the judges, and we got the police. So jumping to the police, I want to start with a quote said by a police officer. So the culture is you're not working unless you're arresting people. Jonathan is going to let you know why this becomes a problem.
Thank you, Philip. So the quota system here in the US justice system is actually an unwritten law. And in fact, they have a name for it. They call it the 20 and 1, which is that you have to, as a police officer, you need to give 20 tickets and one arrest each month as a performance measure. This quantitative measure actually incentivizes police officers to go to communities that are with high risk, and in their perception, that's going to be black neighborhoods. So they actually see black neighborhoods as a source of their revenue. This poses a problem when we start bringing AI into the picture. So here I'll introduce you to Compass, which is the algorithm that's currently being used in the US for judges to give a scoring system for defendants. And it's been used since 2016 in major cities. Now, the algorithm measures recidivism risk, which is the risk of how likely someone is going to recommit a crime. Now, higher scores relate to a higher likelihood of going back to prison, and as I said, used by the judges. Now, there's an investigative journalist body called ProPublica, which has demonstrated that actually Compass is racist. And I'll show you what it means. Here, we've got two different defendants, a black and a white, which has committed similar felonies. Now, Compass has given the black defendant a 10 high risk value, whereas the white defendant gets a low risk. This then translates to the criminal score. However, when they did track these two defendants outside, the black defendant didn't make any more offenses, whereas the white defendant here did 3 more felonies. Going to extrapolate to the population here, we've got two different scenarios where we have humans and the Compass algorithm trying to predict how likely they're going to recidivate. Now, here we already can see that this is a false positive case. Humans already expect black people to make more crimes again. But as you can see, Compass actually amplifies that and takes this and over-expects the black people to recommit crimes. Conversely, on the second scenario where it's a false negative, where they predict that they're not going to recidivate, but they actually do, they underestimate how likely white defendants are going to commit crimes. What does this look like in our whole system diagram? So I'd like to point to the folders that you got for your convenience to page 2. We have our loop here divided into the algorithmic and systemic bias. I'd like to focus more on the systemic bias first, and see here how the perception of minorities will affect their prejudice in cops. Now, this will get amplified again and reinforced based on the quota system that we have here in the US, as shown here. This quota system then aggravates how likely they are going to contact the minorities and lead to a higher arrest in the minorities. This feeds into our second part of the loop, the automation bias, which is affecting here the data sets of the arrest, and the algorithm then reinforces this systemic bias. Now, of course, as Philip mentioned, we have the promise of AI being an objective measure. However, we have here the algorithm being affected by, so it's supposed to be that we have a supervised learning that removes all the errors that, of the unwanted patterns. However, the supervised learning here, we have humans who supervise these algorithms. And if these humans have the same bias as the systemic bias, all we're introducing is reinforcing the same patterns. This causes Compass to have the algorithmic bias. From here, the Compass algorithm then creates a higher score for the black defendants, and it increases the crime sentence for the society. What I just showed you here is sounds like a bleak picture, as the black defendants are being categorically unfairly treated, and they've got nothing to do about it. And this is going to be a bigger issue as AI progresses. What can we do about this? I'll let Rafael talk about our recommendations.
Now that you already know our system and the problem, before bringing the recommendation, I'm going to show you current initiatives that are going right now, and it's going to be important. First, the GDPR. It's a regulation coming out right now in Europe that is related with how companies handle personal data of European citizens. Second, CDO. This is a very important position right now. It's the guy in charge of the data governance, but unfortunately, just 46% of the company already assigned. And last, the data scrubbing. Even that we already have companies capable of cleaning data, we don't have anyone capable of identifying bias and cleaning those bias from data sets. Why it's important? Talking about the recommendations. First, I want to tackle the right side of our loop, as you can see in page 4. We recommend that WEF creates a leadership conference. We focus on the leaders of the policy departments, because we know better leaders can motivate people, and motivated policy officers don't need to rely on the quota system. Talking about the automation bias problem, the left side of our system, we have a scalable solution that can be applied for other industries and systems, as we mentioned in the beginning. We came up with the idea of the AI Watch Institution. So we recommend that WEF incentivize the creation of a global institution that will work with the CDOs to monitor and communicate with them, creating guidelines and metrics and also related with AI. And also the countries and companies are in compliance with that, the AI Watch will issue certifications. So here we have the whole system with the recommendations. First, in the leadership summit, as I mentioned, balancing with the prejudice in COPs. On top of that, to tackle the automation bias problem, we have the CDOs that can balance the data set of arrests and work with the entrepreneurships, as I mentioned before, like to clean data. And finally, the AI Watch guidelines balancing the bias in human supervisor. You can double check the whole system on your folders. Here's the timeline of the implementation. So, in 2018, as I said, the GDPR, and this is important because it's creating a momentum right now in Europe where countries are concerned about data. And then we recommend that WEF came with the leadership conference in 2019 and the AI Watch Summit. And then in 2020, we expect to see the effects of that. Of course, we have risks in this implementation, and we stressed the system to make sure that it's not going to fail. The two main problems are countries not joining, because this is a global institution similar to the United Nations, so it's optional to join or not. And also the changing technologies. To avoid this problem, as I said, GDPR, European countries concerned about data right now, we recommend that WEF take advantage of this moment to convince European countries to join. Once they join, it's going to be easier for the United States, China, and developed countries to be part of that. And second, annual conference. So we recommend that the leadership conference, the AI Watch Summit, become a regular conference where countries can come and share their knowledge and the innovations. Metrics. So we split in three sets of metrics. The first one is to make sure that the implementation of the AI Watch is working. The second one is metrics that the CDO should report to the AI Watch institution. And the most important one is to make sure that the AI Watch have effect on the industry and systems that we mentioned. So for this one in specific, we recommend that WEF partner with global organizations as the World Justice Project. These organizations already have a set of metrics related with the industry. For example, specific for this one, they can tell you if the criminal system is impartial or not. So to finish, I want to let you with three key takeaways. First, we said we split the problem in systemic problem and automation bias. The automation bias is scalable, our solution. But to solve the systemic problem, we need leaders to come and talk and discuss, understand the industry, and come with different ideas. Also, we cannot allow that countries rely on AI as the solution for systemic problems that they don't want to talk about. And finally, as I said, the problem is already here. We need the countries to join the AI Watch right now and solve it. Thank you.
Very nice. Okay, so I will obviously let Kay take the first question on. Kay, can you hear me? Kay, can you hear us?
Can you hear us?
Yes, I can.
I'm here.
So you're asking if we're only going to have the developed countries be part of the leadership conference, or both developed and developing?
I'm asking if you're only having the countries that are leading in the development of AI. Say there's, for example, very little development of AI going on in Vietnam, but should Vietnam still be part of this leadership conference?
So given our research, we do believe that the developing countries should also be part of it, simply because there is corruption in their police systems as well. Even though they're not using AI and they're not, there's no AI biases that are kind of leading their police system, there is still corruption. And so we think that the developing countries could learn from the developed countries who are doing things a little bit differently. And then secondly, these developing countries, you know, in 20 years or 10 years might have caught up to the developed countries, and so for that reason, they can begin learning about these AI biases now.
Okay, would the conference, the leadership conference, simply deal with the biases issues, or would you want it to deal with the other issues that are
so
prevalent today in AI?
Yeah, primarily the bias issues, but I suppose more as a more secondary topic, they could lead into other types of corruption amongst the police systems.
On top of this, it just this leadership forum, it's just part of change management process of leadership in the police. And we would like to show like another way how motivate policemen, for example, go from quantity metrics to quality metrics and do this system transparent and more like best practice oriented. But we are just focused on the left side of our loop because it's just one example how bias works. And we would like more concentrate on how AI watch can solve this problem, connect with the AI context.
Okay, so just so that I'm sure that I understand you, the leadership conference is really for police leadership, or is it for government?
So in this case, when we talk about the issue that we have related to the systemic bias in discriminating against black and whites, yes, we're talking about the police. Now, as Rafael mentioned in our recommendations, we know that to only tackle on with automation bias, we need to tackle on the systemic bias within that particular vertical. So in this case, yes, we would need to tackle with the police officer. If we have to do it with healthcare, perhaps we have to also sit down with the key actors in those things as well and do an analysis similar to how we did today.
And I want to add to that, because if we just focus on the left side, it doesn't solve the actual systematic problem. So whenever we look in different industries, remember our first or our second slide with different industries, the problem is on the right side all the time different. But with AI, we can tackle kind of the same problem, reinforcing biases in each different industry. So this is basically with different industries, we have to do for we have to look for different solutions on the systematic side. And yeah, basically our recommendation is focus, or web should focus on the left side, on the AI side, so that AI doesn't make things actually worse. So that's basically our recommendation for that.
So if I were to be implementing what you are recommending, you would be saying that I should have a leadership conference, for example, bringing together police officers, head chief police officers from around the world to tackle this particular piece. But if I wanted to tackle the healthcare system, I need a separate leadership.
Exactly. Absolutely. You have to look into the different industry and to different solutions. But we're focusing on AI, and we want to make sure or that AI is not making things worse in each industry because of that.
Okay, and so you don't think that one of the things that we are actually doing at the forum is creating a global AI council, which will be comprised of leaders from around the world. You don't think that it's possible to tackle this specific challenge at that level? You think it just needs breaking down into component parts?
Yeah. Specifically, the automate. Can you see our loop here?
No.
Can you see our loop? So the automation bias side of the loop, this side here, is what we feel is scalable amongst all different industries. Whereas the systemic side on this side, more specifically dealing with the quota system and different police systems, that is the side that we feel like has to be altered depending on the industry.
Okay, super. That's very, very interesting and helpful. Thank you very much. Hola.
Yeah, thank you, Kate. A couple of other questions. This sort of builds on Kay's initial question. I understand your rationale for focusing on bias hard, because that's tough enough to get straight on a country by country level, much less an industry by industry level. But the issues of explainability and privacy to some degree are interlinked, right, with bias. So wouldn't you have to somehow at least sort of capture a certain cluster of societal issues to see the interconnections?
Yeah, I think you need to do, so this was a specific example towards the justice system, and as you said, perhaps the other biases, that this loop is only a small fraction of how the overall thing happens in society, right? So you're absolutely right in thinking that we need to actually go deeper into figuring out like what other factors are interplayed and what factors are being amplified for AI.
Okay.
If you look into clusters or like what basically copies from this industry to another, one bias could be, for example, I mean, in the last 10 years, like gender equality, like progressed so much. But if AI comes in, let's say you go into an insurance sector, like basically Google just developed with the insurance industries like an algorithm. And basically what they do, they predict if you all want to get a car insurance, for example. So you want, and you apply that insurance for a car insurance, and then the algorithm tells you you don't get the insurance, but it doesn't tell you why. But what we could do, where AI Watch could come in, is basically like, or what I'm trying to say is like you have the black box. What happens here, no one knows it. Like your feet, the outcome is for the insurance, it doesn't tell you yes or no. But now when you feed this black box with data, the danger is that, for example, women, it predicts the outcome, that women don't get the insurance. But what we could do is not tell AI even that gender exists. So if we can, if we have an AI watching the data streams coming in and telling, or not using the gender even, then this, we make sure that women are not penalized by just being women.
This AI watch is because that currently AI and algorithm making is currently unaudited and unregulated. There's no transparency, and so like Christian was saying, more transparency could.
Yeah, there's really no panel of experts that are looking at code saying, or at data sets saying, we have to scrub this data set, right, by certain variables. That's very interesting. Now, with regard to the metrics, if you go back to your metrics slide. So here, I guess it's nice to see that you guys actually have metrics for this organization. I was wondering, would it make sense to have a metric that says any sort of outcome representation of, let's say, something like arrests per week or per day? And I'm very open to altering the framework, the time duration. But at the end of the year, or the end of a test period, the arrest quota has to resemble diversity distribution across society, or something like that, right? Which sort of gets you into a very tricky spot, because what if you actually do find out that certain parts of the population, certain groups in the population are overrepresented, right? I mean, there are, you know, when you look at medicine, for instance, you are seeing certain illnesses more represented and expressed in certain ethnic minorities, for instance, only because their intolerances, their systems are being hit with the wrong things in society, right? So it's not necessarily a sort of predetermined kind of thing. It's not necessarily a bias thing. It's more of a real-world expression of certain groups in society just being disfavored by certain things like illnesses, right?
There's no doubt about it that this could happen, but actually the data right now is proven differently. Like, this is the slide that Jonathan was presenting. If you could say, explain that platformer to
you. Yeah. I think what you're trying to get at is that there are already, not exactly biases, but there are like environments that already make the people like this, right? I think that's what you're trying to get at. So that's true. That's why I think if you see here, the humans already have this sort of mentality. So let's say you are a black kid living in a black neighborhood, maybe because you get so many people arrested in your neighborhood, you're used to it, and then maybe it makes you okay with doing crime and doing stealing because everyone's like that. So again, like we said, like this is a systemic issue. Even in other industries as well. Like if we're, for example, we've been taken with education. So with education, the scholarship for for students in low income neighborhoods, if they were black, they get less chance to get it if they were in a low income neighborhood for a white. And these are data that's already embedded right now in the system. If we're not fixing the system, AI is just going to amplify this situation. Yeah,
very true. What do you do with countries like China, for instance, where we may have discussed this in class, but when we talk about it, and I had a similar conversation with government officials in Singapore, who say this bias stuff, not a big problem for us. And I said, well, does bias not exist in Singapore? And they say, well, it's not the question whether it exists, it's the question whether it matters. Right? So, and in China, we've had interviews where people said, so you're concerned with minority rights? And we say, yes. And they say, but minorities are small groups by definition, right? And we say, yes. And they're like, so where's the problem? So how do you get a country like China, which goes back to Kay's first question, which is probably the leading or one of the two or three leading countries in the world for AI, how do you get them to join something like that?
So we said that AI Watch is also issuing certificates for countries joining, and we thought about, okay, why might a country not join AI Watch? But
right.
There is no reason for not joining, because we're not restricting them. We are cleaning, AI Watch is cleaning data. So we are cleaning data and we are issuing certificates. So if a country gets this kind of certificate, it becomes, the public relation gets better, because everybody knows, okay, this country is using clean AI, or however you want to call it. But that's a benefit for the country, not really a restriction.
Yeah. Adding to that, remember that I said that this organization should work similar to the United Nations. If you see, one of the reasons that countries join in the United Nations is because they don't want to be out of the decision-making process. So it's kind of like, if China decides to not join in the end, we will have like probably the European countries plus the United States, important countries also related with AI, and China will be outside of this decision-making process. So that's one of the reasons. And when you think about the companies inside the country, as Philip said, we will issue certifications. So for the brand image of the company is not also good, because in the end, you know those countries that are AI certificate or not.
Yeah.
On top of this, it just already exists some relationship, for example, with Google and Apple. And potentially, if you will not join AI Watch, they can lose this like business relationship, because like Google and Apple would require the same quality as they expected from American OEM.
So there's reputational pressure,
yeah.
Is what you're saying. Okay.
And also, we're saying today that we don't issue laws, or like we don't implement laws with AI Watch. It's the first step. Who knows, like in 10 years, maybe it becomes that mature that we have the ability to maybe restrict, or, but in order to keep that entry barrier low, we have to start somewhere. And that's why we're saying, okay, let's start with guidelines, let's work from here, and then take
okay.
it maybe in 5 years a little step further.
Great. One final question, and I know we're already over, but it's an interesting one in this context. So when you think about what kind of pressures, what kind of forces and trends usually lead to more bias in society, there are things like terrorist events, right?
Mm-hmm.
Terrorism occurs and it must have been a Muslim, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now imagine this system getting hit
mm-hmm.
with a heavy dose of terrorism events over the course of a year. How will it be anti-fragile? Will it withstand the pressure?
I think that just we mentioned media in our loop, and media just play a huge role in this process, because when we just mentioned terrorist attack, it's like media usually say that it's Muslim people, and it just like crime in America, it doesn't mention that it's just white person, for example. And I think it's important to like some social organization can control media to don't like grow these floor, because it just create more bias than it were before. It's a media like also like huge player in our system.
Yeah, to build up what Maria was saying here about the media attention here, which is reinforcing to maybe here's what Kagan see. We have a media attention here which affects the perception of minorities here. And I guess this is going to be something that we should have WEF to start a conference and a talk where you have the key actors to address the perception. So for example, in the US, we have a strong perception of Muslims doing terrorist attacks, and that's likely because of how much the media is putting so much attention to and glorifying this. And in fact, like for example, CNN the US and CNN around like the UK is probably different showing portrayal of this.
And for example, if we're back to our case, like Fibiaric before 2015, public data about how much they arrested black people and white people. And after this year, they stopped to do it. And one of the reasons, because the media uses it and public like this data, that is black people like do crime much more bigger than white.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So media,
And it was happened after a Trump scandal when he used this data in public in his Twitter that it's happened, and after it was a big like scandal and stopped to do it. And one of the example why we should not use this data for media.
So media needs to be part of this organization
yeah.
somehow, because you can eradicate bias in functional organizations like police departments, but if the media keeps pounding the public with bad data.
Yeah.
Then that's futile, right?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you, team.